In this video, we introduce the sine and cosine functions on the unit circle. So we start out very fundamental here and get a ground level definition of what these functions are. And this is a pretty important moment because everything we know about trigonometry flows from these definitions. After defining sine and cosine, we're going to figure out how to sketch their graphs. And we'll see why sines and cosines are really the building blocks of the mathematics of waves. Finally, we're going to learn how to evaluate the sine and cosine functions in exact form at the special angles we normally define in trigonometry and calculus. So we're going to use only two special triangles to navigate the entire unit circle and determine the values of sine and cosine at any special angle we want. So let's get things started with the basic definitions of sine and cosine of an angle. And what we're looking at here is a picture of the unit circle, meaning a circle of radius 1 centered at the origin. We're interested in a point on the unit circle that lies at an angle of theta measured counterclockwise from the positive x-axis, and that point is labeled as the ordered pair xy. So the definitions of sine and cosine are actually really simple. Cosine theta is just the x-coordinate of that point on the unit circle, and sine theta is just the y-coordinate of that point on the unit circle. So this allows us to immediately start computing some sines and cosines of a few special angles. So this set of examples just focuses on the cardinal directions on the unit circle. We don't need any special triangles to evaluate sine and cosine at the cardinal directions. So we'll start with cosine of 0, and an angle of 0 is right here, and I can see the x-coordinate of that point. Because we're talking about a circle of radius 1, the x-coordinate is 1. Again, that's just because this is the point 1, 0. If I look at the cosine of pi, pi is half of 2 pi, and 2 pi is the total angle in the unit circle. So pi is over here. That's the point negative 1, 0, and I can see the cosine of pi is negative 1. Now a couple examples with the sine function. The sine of 0 is 0, because that's the y-coordinate of this point. And the sine of pi over 2, well, pi over 2 is a 90 degree angle or straight up on the unit circle, and that has the ordered pair 0, 1. The y-coordinate is 1, so the sine of pi over 2 is 1. So we can always get the sine and cosine of these angles that are sitting at the cardinal directions just by going back and thinking about the definition of sine and cosine. So I want to make a quick point about minimum and maximum values of these two functions. You probably already noticed that the cosine function oscillates between a maximum value of positive 1, and that happens at an angle of 0, and a minimum value of negative 1, which happens at an angle of pi. So the minimum value of the cosine function is negative 1, and this occurs at an angle of pi. The maximum value is positive 1, occurring at an angle of 0. For the sine function, we already saw its maximum value occurring at pi over 2, and the minimum value occurs at this angle of 3 pi over 2. That's just pi over 2 added to pi. So I have, again, a minimum value of negative 1, but for the sine function, that occurs at 3 pi over 2, and then the maximum value, again, is positive 1, occurring at pi over 2. Finally, I want to point out that both of these functions are periodic with a period of 2 pi radians. This means the values of these functions will be the same if we add or subtract an integer multiple of 2 pi from the angle, since that just loops around the circle an integer number of times back to the same point. So if we really wanted to be general here, we would say each of these values has a plus or minus k times 2 pi, and each function achieves its minimum and maximum values an infinite number of times, just corresponding to multiple added rotations around the circle in either direction. So we'll finish this chapter by looking at a couple examples of angles that are actually larger than 2 pi. In the first one, I have the cosine of 3 pi, which means we go around the circle once to get to 2 pi, and then we go an extra pi, and we still end up over here at the point negative 1, 0. So the cosine of 3 pi, that's just negative 1. In the second example, we have the sine of 5 pi over 2. Well, 4 pi over 2 is 2 pi. That's one full rotation around the circle, and then we just go pi over 2 past that, and we land at the point 0, 1. So the sine of 5 pi over 2, that's just positive 1. Next, we're focusing on graphing the sine and cosine functions as functions of theta. In other words, we'll graph them as functions on a two-dimensional plot. And in our picture, I've taken our y component of the radius of the unit circle, and I've colored that magenta, and I've taken the x component and colored it green. So we have the x and y components of the radius as the angle theta advances counterclockwise around the unit circle. And the length of that green x component tells us the value of the cosine function, provided we put a minus sign on it when it's left of the y-axis, because that's when our x-coordinate is negative. We can also say the length of that y component tells us the value of sine theta, provided we put a minus sign on it when it's below the x-axis, because that's where the y-coordinate is negative. So as theta increases from zero, we see the value of the sine starts at zero and is growing, and the cosine starts at a value of one and it's shrinking. When we get to pi over two, the sine function takes its maximum value of one and the cosine is zero. And then the cosine becomes negative, but it's growing larger and the sine begins to shrink. The cosine reaches its minimum value of negative one and the sine reaches zero and crosses into negative values. And then our sine function reaches its minimum value of negative one while the cosine arrives at a value of zero again. And finally, we return to the initial position and the behavior simply repeats as the angle exceeds 2π and starts the next cycle. Now on the next cycle, we can plot the values of these functions with respect to theta in two-dimensional graphs. So now we can get a picture of the behavior of sine and cosine over the course of an entire period. Notice that these graphs are starting to look like waves, and for this reason, the sine and cosine functions are the basis of all the math we need to describe wave motion. We can continue into another rotation, extending our domain past 2π. And this wave motion is simply going to repeat periodically with a period of 2π. So now we have a really clear sense that what we're looking at with the sine and cosine functions is waves that have an amplitude of 1 in a period of 2π. Finally, we're going to learn how to calculate the values of the sine and cosine functions at all the special angles that we normally use in trigonometry and calculus. If you aren't familiar with how these angles were calculated, I'll post a link at the top to a video that shows how to quickly calculate all these angles. The main point I want to emphasize is that every one of these special angles corresponds to one of two special triangles whose legs tell us the x and y components at that angle, and therefore the values of the sine and cosine functions. So the first triangle is this one. That's a 45-45-90 triangle. Just a quick reminder here, in radians, the angle pi over 4 is the same thing as 45 degrees. And this one triangle allows us to reach four different points on the unit circle that are labeled with special angles. We can flip across the y-axis, and now we're looking at the angle 3π over 4, or 135 degrees. Flip that one across the x-axis, and we get to 5π over 4, or 225 degrees. And go back across the y-axis, and we're looking at 7π over 4, or 315 degrees. So if we can nail down the length of the legs of this triangle, we're automatically going to get the sine and cosine values at all of these different special angles. All we have to do is take care to put the correct plus or minus sign on the lengths of those legs. And this right triangle is isosceles. It has two angles that are the same at 45 degrees, and then the leftover angle is 90. This means the lengths of the two legs are going to be the same. So what I did is just call those A. Now we apply the Pythagorean theorem, and we can say the sum of the squares of the legs, that's a squared plus a squared, is equal to the square of the hypotenuse. So we can say 2a squared is equal to 1. That means a squared is 1/2, which then means a is 1 over the square root of 2. Notice I only kept the positive solution there because we're talking about the length of a leg. Now, 1 over square root 2 is a perfectly fine way to represent this length, but sometimes teachers insist that you rationalize all denominators, and so we would just multiply the top and bottom by square root 2, and we get an alternative way to represent this, which is square root 2 over 2. So there's the length of the legs of the 45 degree type triangle. Now let's find the values of sine and cosine at a bunch of these angles. So in our first example, we're asked for the sine of pi over 4, and that's the triangle we originally showed in the diagram. Well, the length of this vertical leg is simply 1 over square root 2, And the y-coordinate is positive there, so the sine function has a value of 1 over root 2 at an angle of pi over 4, and you could, of course, write that as square root 2 divided by 2 if you prefer. Next, we want to find the cosine of 5 pi over 4. So I just move my triangle over there to the third quadrant. Again, the lengths of the two legs are both 1 over square root 2, or root 2 over 2. And I can see the x-coordinate of this point is negative. So I have the length of this leg right here, 1 over root 2, but the value of the x-coordinate is negative 1 over root 2. So there's the cosine of 5 pi over 4. Finally, we want the sine of 7 pi over 4. So we arrange our 45, 45, 90 triangle to point to this angle in the fourth quadrant. And again, the lengths of these legs are both the same. They're always 1 over root 2 or square root 2 over 2. And this time the y-coordinate is negative because we're below the x-axis. And again, the sine function is just the y-coordinate of a point on the unit circle. So that's going to be negative 1 over root 2. Now the second triangle we need is going to reach 8 different points on the unit circle. So far we've covered how you analyze sine and cosine at the cardinal directions, in other words, straight up and straight down, left and right. And we've covered all the angles you can reach with a 45, 45, 90 triangle. Now we're looking at all the angles you can reach with a 30, 60, 90 triangle. So here's the first one I wanted to look at. It's pointing to this point on the unit circle that has an angle of 30 degrees or pi over 6. And so this triangle is going to give us access to every single angle that's 30 degrees away from one of the cardinal directions. I'm not going to include an exhaustive list here because there's too many of them, but there's an example of how we would reach the point at 2 pi over 3 or 120 degrees. It's the same triangle, just flipped over. There we're getting access to the angle 5 pi over 3 or 300 degrees. And there we're getting access to the angle 7 pi over 6 or 210 degrees. So the key to finding the sine and cosine of all these different angles is to find the lengths of these two legs of a 30, 60, 90 triangle. Now this time the legs don't have the same length. And the trick to getting these nailed down is actually to paste two of these triangles together. So there's two 30, 60, 90 triangles pasted together. And I can see that I have a hypotenuse for the first one of 1 over here on the left, 1 on the right over here. But what's special about this total triangle we just created is that this angle at the top is 60 degrees, and that makes this whole thing a 60, 60, 60, or equilateral triangle. That means the total length of that bottom side is equal to the other two sides, and that's 1. So I can immediately say 2b is equal to 1, and b, the short side of the 30, 60, 90 triangle with a hypotenuse of 1, is just 1/2. So that short side is 1/2. And now we can use the Pythagorean theorem to find A. I'm just going to look at one of these triangles now and look at the sum of the squares of the legs. So that's 1/2 squared plus A squared. And that's equal to the square of the hypotenuse, which is 1 squared. So this gives me 1/4 plus A squared is equal to 1. I subtract a fourth from both sides and I end up with a squared equals 3/4. And then I take the square root and I end up with a equals square root of 3 over 2. So the long side of this 30, 60, 90 triangle has a length of square root 3 divided by 2. So let's take a look at evaluating sine and cosine at all of these angles that are offset by 30 degrees from the cardinal directions. First, we'll do the sine of pi over 6. And again, the sine function tells you the y-coordinate of this point on the unit circle. I can see that corresponds to the short leg of the 30, 60, 90 triangle, and it's positive. So the sine of pi over 6 is 1/2. Next, we'll do the cosine of 7 pi over 6. So we just rotate our triangle and relocate it so that we're pointing at this angle 7 pi over 6, or 210 degrees. And the cosine is the x-coordinate of that point. Well, this horizontal leg has a length of root 3 over 2, but the x-coordinate is negative over here. So I need to put a minus sign on that. The x-coordinate of that point is negative square root 3 over 2. Finally, we arrange our 30, 60, 90 triangle to point at the angle 5 pi over 3, or 300 degrees, and we want the value of the cosine function there. So we want the x-coordinate of that point. That corresponds to the short leg of this triangle. And x is positive here, so the cosine of 5 pi over 3 is positive 1/2. So just as a final note, I want to emphasize that the values of the trig functions at all these special angles only require that you remember a couple different things. First, you want to remember the definition of the sine and the cosine functions, just as the x and y coordinates of a point located on the unit circle. That immediately gets you the values of the sine and cosine functions at all the cardinal directions, so 0, pi over 2, pi, and 3 pi over 2. And then you just have to know the side lengths of two simple triangles. And you can just move those around to all these other special angles in order to nail down the values of the sine and cosine function. In the next video, we learn how to extend the basic definitions of sine and cosine in order to do right triangle trigonometry. In other words, we're going to be solving triangles that aren't constrained to having a hypotenuse of 1 on the unit circle. When it's ready, you'll find a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.